Hello, this is the switchboard of Picture Page. You want to see who? Miss Adele Dixon opening BBC television? Just wait a moment. Miss Dixon's coming into the studio now. You're through.
A mighty maze of mystic magic rays is all about us in the blue. And in sight and sound they trace living pictures out of space to bring a new wonder to you. The busy
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Leslie Mitchell introducing The Birth of Television.
To see Eric Wilde and his tea timers? Just one moment. You're through.
If we'd had a late night, which we weren't supposed to do, and frequently did, the cameraman or the lighting engineer would put a gauze in front of the camera to make us look a little less hungover.
Well, they took me in this tiny box, and they said, sing. I said, but there's nothing to sing to.
I'd already learned stage technique and film technique. Now I had to start on television technique.
We had absolutely no idea that we were making history.
Yes, Johnny Knitt's ready now.
Johnny Knitt danced on this very floor, believe it or not, just 40 years ago. A few days before that, on November the 2nd, 1936, I, as senior announcer, had announced the official opening of the first high-definition public television service in the world, here in the studios of Alexandra Palace. Fewer than 1,000 people had their own television sets, but the nation's interest, the world's interest in what the papers called the new miracle was enormous. From those early days, very little program material survives. Videotape recording didn't come into use until 1960, of course. So all we have is some old film and a few photographs. But what do survive are people. And the reconstructions that you'll see in this program have been made with the help of the pioneers who originally made television.
The Times. June the 27th, 1923. Seeing by wireless. Inventor of apparatus wishes to hear from someone who will assist, not financially, in making models work. Write Box S, 65.
I was in the office. It was a day when I was on office duty for call. And the chief sent for me and he said, "Oh, Fox, there's a fellow down in the waiting room on the first floor. He says he's done something with electricity. I don't know what it is. Go down, see what he's got to say, but make sure he hasn't got any knives on him."
John Logie Baird, son of the Reverend William Baird, was born in Helensburgh near Glasgow in 1888. At the age of 6, he saved his halfpenny a week pocket money to buy a toy camera. Baird spent much of his childhood ill in bed, so he rigged up a homemade electric light and a homemade telegraph to keep in touch with the outside world.
"Listen to him, be very careful, don't promise him anything, and get rid of him. I didn't want to see any more of these inventor fellows."
After graduating from the Royal Technical College in Glasgow, Baird took a job as superintendent of the Clyde Valley Electric Power Station, where he experimented with making artificial diamonds. Baird made his first commercial venture in 1919. Having learned the art of publicity, in 1 year he made a profit of nearly £2,000. The undersocks were ordinary socks sprinkled with borax. In 1921, Baird went to Trinidad as a travelling salesman. After selling only £5 of safety pins in 3 weeks, he established a makeshift jam factory in the shimmering heat of the jungle. The venture failed, and at the age of 34, he returned to England and his early interest, television.
He said, "I can send images by wireless," or a vague expression like that.
Radio Times, February 1924. J.L. Baird has succeeded in transmitting the outlines of objects.
In April 1925, Baird demonstrated his shadowgraphs at Selfridges.
"Those who listen to broadcasting will be amazed at being able to actually see by wireless."
Having succeeded in transmitting silhouettes, Baird introduced television's first ever personality, Stooky Bill, to see if he could transmit an image using light reflected from its face. On October the 25th, 1925, Baird made his trial.
"I could scarcely believe my eyes. The image formed itself on the screen. I had got it. I felt myself shaking with excitement. Dear sir, at my laboratory in Frith Street, Soho, I am giving a demonstration of my television to members of the Royal Institution on January the 26th, 1926. And wondered whether an observer from the Times would care to be present."
The only surviving eyewitness of that first demonstration was the pressman who'd first interviewed Baird, Bill Fox.
And he'd say, "I'm giving a demonstration, so-and-so, come and see me." In due course, I turned up, groaning all the way, because I'd found him a bit of a nuisance with his constant demands for attention. "We want you to hold the visitor's book for us. See that nobody comes into the demonstration who has not signed the book." You can imagine what it was like on a second floor concrete staircase with an iron railing down to the street, wind whistling round my ankles all the time. I began to hear the sounds of footsteps coming from the street door up the steps, patiently, slowly, up to me. And the members arrived in twos and threes to be stopped by me and say, "Will you please sign?" They were good boys, they all did. All well-known scientists. He said to me, "Once you know the great danger is, these big firms will get hold of my idea and take it, and I shall be left sitting with nothing." And for that reason, he was very, very secretive.
"Good evening, gentlemen. Evening. Professor, if you'll come this way, please."
"Yes, thank you very much.
One at a time, please."
"I hope."
"Good evening, Doctor." "Good evening." "Good evening, sir." "Good evening. Come in, please." No, sir, I'm afraid I'll have to trouble you to wait out here. Only three at a time. Thank you."
The Times, London, January the 28th, 1926. The image was often blurred, but it substantiated a claim that it is possible to transmit and reproduce instantly such things as the play of expression on the human face.
I'd say they didn't believe a bit. They thought it was all a trick or something equally disreputable. I did hear one fellow say, oh, a mere mountebank, he's after what he can get. A young man doesn't know what he's doing. And one fellow came out very definitely and said, well, what's the good of it when you've got it? What useful purpose will it serve?
Television for sale. £6, 10 shillings and a penny.
Looking in, new move. Hope of television for all this year.
Our idea is to have research laboratories and a power station on a parallel scale to the BBC.
Baird recruited Ben Clapp.
I joined Baird the same year that he gave his first demonstration. I was his first engineer, and I was constructing amplifiers and other equipment that he required. He wouldn't tell me anything what he was doing, except I knew he was working on television. He wouldn't show me any of his equipment, and he certainly wouldn't allow me in where the transmitting equipment was. But eventually he had to let me in, and this is what I saw. A large transmitting disc with a series of lenses in a spiral, a photoelectric cell contained in this box, a series of amplifiers, a neon lamp, and a smaller disc with pinholes in the same order that the lenses were on the large transmitting disc. These discs revolved at a tremendous speed. The dummy, the other side of the wall, is viewed by the photocell through the lenses. When the photocell in here sees a bright part of the face, as it produces a lot of electricity, a dark part of the face, a smaller amount of electricity. These electrical impulses are amplified by these amplifiers and put onto the neon lamp here, which varies in brightness according to the light or dark part of the image that is being looked at by the photoelectric cell here. These image then on the neon lamp is looked at through the pinholes in this disc and viewed from the other side. These lenses, being mounted as a spiral, scan. The first lens scans the one strip of the face, the second lens is the adjoining strip, and so on until the whole face has been covered. The purpose of the pinhole disc is to reassemble those strips in their correct order as seen from the other side of the wall by anybody looking in. Later on, this receiving part of the equipment could be miles away in a viewer's home, then be necessary for the two discs to be run in absolute synchronism. Otherwise, the face would be assembled in its wrong order. That can't happen here because these two discs are mounted on the same shaft as they were in Baird's original equipment, and this is how it ran. There was nothing new in this sort of thing. People had been talking about it for the last 50 years. But my old boss, Logie Baird, was the first one to make it work, and he did it entirely by himself.
To show his system and sell his sets, Baird needed the support of the only organization licensed to broadcast, the BBC. In October 1928, he invited them to a hush-hush demonstration.
A curiously ape-like head, swaying up and down in a streaky stream of yellow light. The effect is more grotesque than impressive. The demonstration might well be considered an insult to the intelligence. It would be merely ludicrous if its financial implications did not make it sinister.
The private remarks of the BBC were more diplomatically expressed in their public pronouncements.
In order that its listeners may not suffer disappointment by anticipating the possibility of seeing as well as hearing its performances, the BBC wishes to make it plain that it has not, so far, been approached with apparatus of so practical a nature as, in the opinion of the corporation, to make television possible on a service basis.
Observer, an important announcement by the Baird Television Development Company Limited. Practical television is here. Our new transmitting station at 133 Longacre is nearing completion. We propose to commence broadcasting our own programs.
Under pressure from the post office, who threatened to break the broadcasting monopoly, the BBC capitulated, and on September the 30th, 1929, the corporation made its first transmission of a Baird programme, a piano recital by Cyril Smith. But the BBC hadn't the transmitters to carry sound and vision simultaneously.
In granting facilities for these experimental demonstrations in which the public can, if they so desire, take part, neither the Postmaster General nor the BBC accept any responsibility for the quality of transmission or the results obtained.
Baird hit back.
My name it is Jenny. And folks around here call me Jenny, because that is my name. I work on a farm every month of the year and each day of the week just the same. Now, I've fallen in love. I've fallen in love with a good lad, you know. And I think he's a fancy for me. Because only last evening we sat on the bench underneath the old sycamore tree. And we got to one another and never said nout about out. He come out a walking with me, you know, and down in the field where the turnips grow, we sat holding hands for an hour or so, and never said nout about out. Not out, about out. We never said nout about out. Well, at milking or churning or feeding the chickens, I think of it.
In March 1930, with the opening of the Brookman's Park transmitter, the BBC were at last able to transmit sound and picture together. To celebrate this event, Baird engaged our Gracie, and this is what she sang.
About out, and just for a minute, the moon were hid. So into his arms with a bump I slid. And I'm not going to tell you just what we did, but we never said nout about out. Not out, about out. We never said nout about out.
Even for a star performer like Gracie Fields, television was a bewildering experience.
So I'm put in a little room. The smallest room, well, it was about as big as the smallest, telephone kiosk you see in the street, you know. And they put me in there, and they said, you're going to sing through here. Well, all I could see looked like to me, just a brick wall. Are you kidding? Are you pulling my leg? They said, no, it goes in there, and it's going to be seen a mile away. And somebody's pulling my leg, all right. Well, I'm used to singing in so many places, so all right, we go in there and I get myself, I'm locked inside this little room and I start to sing. When I grow too old to dream, I'll have you to remember.
Turn to the competition page. Don't miss this unique opportunity of winning a Baird television.
I made my first appearance on a Baird televisor in 1932. Baird commissioned 1,000 tin lizzies, as we called them, from Plessy. They were really very simple receivers.
Like so. Here's the rotating disc with pinholes in it, which corresponds to the pinhole disc on Baird's original machine at Frith Street. Spin your pinhole disc in front of the lamp here at the same speed as the distant transmitter. And that took some doing, I can tell you. And you build up your television picture just here. You could buy a set like that for 25 guineas. Or if you didn't feel like risking your money, you could always watch on a public set in a store like Selfridge's. Because public interest in television was suddenly growing enormously.
The televisor was housed in a darkened booth where viewers watched programs like this. What the viewer did not see was the size of the Long Acre studio and the conditions under which the ladies performed. The position of the camera was fixed, so as the camera couldn't tilt down to the floor had to come up to the camera. The performing area, if you'll pardon the pun, was 2 square feet.
Compañero de mi vida, cuidado con esa zanja. No se le quiebra el pértigo. Pítese buen.
Ladies and gentlemen, the man with a flower in his mouth.
An avenue lined with trees, electric lights gleaming through the foliage. Among the houses to the left, a miserable all-night cafe with tables and chairs on the pavement. Faintly from a distance, there comes the sound of a departing train. The man with the flower in his mouth is seated at one of the tables, silently observing the customer, who, at a neighboring table, is sipping a mint frappe through a straw.
Ah, so you've missed your train.
Yes. I got to the station, and there it was, just pulling out.
You might have caught it by running.
This was Britain's first television play.
I suppose I might. It's absurd, I know. But if I hadn't been all cluttered up with all those packages, a dozen more or less, I'd have caught it. Why, it took me 3 minutes after I got out of my taxi to get my fingers through the strings of all those packages. Two to every finger.
It was chosen because it had no action and only 3 characters.
I should have liked to have seen you. Do you know what I would have done?
No.
I'd have left the damn things in the carriage.
Oh, and when you got home? How about the old woman and my daughters, not to mention the neighbors?
Oh, let them yap. I should have enjoyed it.
Every time one character made way for another, the producer had to insert a checkered board to prevent the camera from being upset by the movement.
But you don't know what it's like to be on holiday in the country with a bunch of women.
I think I do. In fact, I do.
And the worst of it is, in my hurry to get away, I left the keys to my house in town at home.
And so?
And so?
The play was broadcast on July the 14th, 1930. And to celebrate the event, the Manchester Guardian wrote its first review of television drama.
For not having a televisor of my own, I had to rely on the apparatus of a multiple store. This could only be seen by one person at a time. As there were over 100 waiting, and our time before the machine was limited, I arrived at the screen at the instant of fade-out.
Death. You understand? Cancer has put this flower in my mouth.
And it's Cameronian, closely followed by Orphan and Sandwich.
In 1931, Baird went to Epsom and achieved the world's first daylight broadcast.
And at the post, that is the order. Cameronian first, Orphan second, and Sandwich third.
The Daily Herald. The result astonished us all. We had found the stepping stone to a new era in which mechanical eyes will see for us great events as they happen and convey them to us in our homes.
On May the 15th, 1932, the BBC opened Broadcasting House.
National programme from London. Now you're going to hear the first performance of the new BBC Dance Orchestra, directed by Henry Hall.
It's just the time for dancing. Tomorrow is today.
As Henry Hall swung the BBC into a new era of sound radio, down in the basement, struggling against internal opposition, a television studio was being prepared.
Although low-definition television is still feeling its way, it has such potentiality that the BBC is lending as much of its time and resources as is consistent with the normal demands of programmes.
Television? Now, I'm the fellow who can tell you about television. I was in at the start, in 1800 and frozen to death. You see, I got this letter from the BBC, so I thought, naturally, it'll be another Monday night at 7 or John Sharman's music hall. Listen what it says. Dear Mr. Askew, A-S-K-E-W, can't spell my name right, we have much pleasure in offering you an engagement to appear on a BBC experimental television programme on Tuesday the 18th of August. Television. You will be offered a fee of 2 guineas. Will you please report to Broadcasting House at 10 o'clock in the morning so that we can arrange your makeup? Makeup. 2 guineas. Oh, I don't know. Pay the rent. That's the makeup.
Aye, there you go.
Well, let's have a look at it.
Oh. Oh, get the kids to bed. Get Grandma under the stairs. Oh, look. Christopher Lee is saying his prayers. Well, this is how it was, playmates. Black and white, you see, and a bit of blue down each side of the nose. Very sexy, yeah. But wait a minute, wait till you see the suit. Ta-da! Arthur Askey is wearing the latest in tuxedos and also has a yellow shirt. On anybody else, this would look horrible. On me, it looks revolting. Anyway, that's it, playmates. Well, now, to the studio. Walk this way. If I could walk that way, I wouldn't need the talcum powder. Oh, crikey. I'd forgotten they looked like this. I remember now. I thought it was in the gent's loo. Anyone like a game of chess? Hey. Ah! It all comes back to me now. Now, this is what is known as the microphone, and over here we have photoelectric cells. Sound like Magnus Pike, don't I? Hey? Stand on what? I can't stand on this. Well, I do a lot of this, you see, a lot of... Oh, all right, Hitchcock. Have it your own way. Television. It'll never take on. What a load of rubbish this is. Wasting my time. Telebloomin' vision. Cool. I'm getting spots before my very eyes.
The flying spot was a new Baird technique. Rather than flood the poor performer with light and pick up the image with spinning lenses, he reversed the process and scanned the subject with a small spot of light. Any light reflected from the face was picked up by the photocells and so turned into electricity.
Tony Bridgewater, who operated the control room.
Well, playmates, I'm going to sing a little song for you now. It's a new song and it's called The Bee.
The pianist was hidden behind light-proof curtains because any extra light in the studio would upset the photocells.
Oh, what a glorious thing to be, a healthy grown-up, busy, busy bee, whiling away the passing hours, pinching all the pollen from the cauliflowers. I'd like to be a busy, busy bee, being just as busy as a bee can be, flying round the garden, streets never seen, taking back the honey to the dear old queen. Buzz, 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 honey bee, honey bee, buzz if you like, but don't sting me. Buzz, 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 honey bee, honey bee, buzz if you like, but don't sting me. Buzz. Bum? What's that? Keep me arms in. Oh, good, isn't it marvellous? Oh,
what a glorious thing to be, a healthy grown-up, busy bee, making hay while time is ripe.
The electricity from the photoelectric cells was reconverted by domestic televisors into quite an acceptable picture, considering it only had 30 lines.
Tony Bridgewater, ex-Baird engineer, was one of the few BBC men who knew anything about television.
Silly bee song, isn't it, eh?
The flying spot was produced using a mirror drum scanner, like this, which fitted inside the transmitter. That's the transmitter, looking into the studio. This was now looking more like a camera. It could slide horizontally, and we could even swivel and tilt it a little. The performer had to wear contrasty clothes and makeup, otherwise we wouldn't get a clear picture. But now we could shoot head and shoulders, even full length. Though then you couldn't recognize faces, only see the action. So we went frequently back to close-up, and then we had to ask the performers not to move too much. Otherwise they'd go out of the picture.
Honeybee. I must buzz off. Buzz if you like, but don't sting me. Hey, there you go. Television. It'll never get anywhere.
We felt that to make the infant television get off to a good start, we had to be as enterprising as we possibly could.
Douglas Birkinshaw, first head of BBC television engineering.
There was an act appearing at the Victoria Palace, a performing sea lion, which our producer was very keen to have in the programme, even though it meant bringing it to the austere broadcasting house of those days. But there was no means of transport which could readily be arranged, and so I, as the owner of a very old motor car, a 1923 Panhard open tourer, volunteered to go and fetch it. Well, I just concentrated on the driving. She was such a good passenger, you know. She sat in the back, laid her head on the back of my driving seat, her whiskers tickled the back of my neck, and she was perfectly behaved. We arrived at Broadcasting House without any trouble.
Television people are the absolute limit.
For your information, performing animals will in future only be admitted by the goods entrance.
You would think it quite ludicrous today, but for us who were in it at the time, it was fascinating that television was possible at all.
The BBC is anxious to know the number of people who are actually seeing this television program. Will those who are looking in send a postcard marked Z to Broadcasting House immediately? This information is of considerable importance.
The results were never published, but the BBC in September 1933 announced the end of its exclusive contract with Baird. Baird's shares fell heavily on the stock exchange. Was the BBC about to close down? It seemed like the end of television.
Gentlemen.
In fact, it was a new beginning.
Among the many scientific problems which await solution, problems which, if satisfactorily solved, would have an enormous effect on the habits of mankind, is that of distant electric vision, or the power to see objects a great way off by electrical means.
In June 1911, A.A. Campbell Swinton, member of the Royal Institution, the distinguished electrical engineer who had encouraged the young Marconi, proposed how distant electric vision might be achieved.
By the employment of two beams of cathode rays, one at the transmitting and one at the receiving station, synchronously deflected by the varying fields of two electromagnets placed at right angles to one another.
The electronic circuit he proposed was the blueprint for the circuit used in television today.
In the diagrammatic illustration, the transmitter is shown here on the left and the receiver on the right-hand side. I would explain that I do not for a moment suppose it would be got to work without a deal of experiment and probably much modification.
It couldn't work because man had not yet invented the technology to make it work.
It is indeed only an effort of my imagination.
1 week later, the Russian Boris Rosing proposed a mechanical television transmitting system with a cathode ray tube screen for the receiver. 18 years later, in 1926 in America, Rosing's pupil, Vladimir Zvorykin, developed his ideas of electronic scanning for the transmitter. In the same year, John Logie Baird produced his first television pictures by mechanical scanning to a firm rebuff from Campbell Swinton.
I fear that Baird and his colleagues are rogues, clever rogues, who are fleecing the ignorant public.
But the press were too busy with Baird to listen. Campbell Swinton died in 1930, but not his ideas. H.M. Viet Hayes in Middlesex were beginning to feel the draft of the Depression. Sales of records and radios were falling. They turned to television. They amalgamated in 1931 with Columbia to form EMI. As a result, another expatriate Russian, Isaac Schoenberg, headed one of the most brilliant teams ever assembled in Britain. Cunliffe, Brown, Blumlein, and joining them from the Cavendish Research Laboratory in Cambridge, J.D. McGee.
When I joined EMI in 1932, C.O. Brown was developing a mechanical transmitting system. It was a 120-line mirror drum film scanning system to generate picture signals for a picture transmitting system. At the receiving end, TEDM was using high vacuum cathode ray tubes as picture receivers, the first to be designed and made in the United Kingdom. TEDM and I used the picture signals from C.O. Brown's film scanning equipment to test our cathode ray tubes.
The picture scanned came from contemporary newsreel film, and the cathode ray tube provided a picture of not 30, but 100.
In the transmission and in the reception of television. When would it be possible for you to come? I should be ready for you at a few hours' notice.
Although a mechanical transmitting system was still being used, the success of the cathode ray tubes as picture receivers convinced Tedham and me that an all-electronic system based on the 20-year-old proposals of Campbell Swinton was the only way in which we could achieve satisfactory television.
Heading the BBC delegation was the man whose opinion counted most and whose decision could be final, Controller of Engineering Sir Noel Ashbridge.
The quality of reproduction was good. That is to say, one could easily distinguish what was happening. Compared with the Baird system, the definition is much greater and the flicker much reduced. Whatever defects there may be, they represent by far the best wireless television I have ever seen, and are probably better than anything anywhere in the world.
During the summer of 1932, we diverted some of the effort that should have been devoted to ordinary cathode ray tubes to the development of what we hoped would be a television picture transmitting tube. And by that autumn, we had it working, and this is it. This is essentially a cathode ray tube, a glass tube from which nearly all the air has been removed to produce a very high vacuum. In this glass extension tube, we mount an electron gun which fires a sharply focused beam of electrons at this target. The target takes the place of the fluorescent screen of a conventional cathode ray tube. This device has often been called an electronic eye, and in that analogy, this target is the retina of the eye. It consists of an insulated metal plate, and on the front surface of this, we form a very large number of minute globules of silver, which are insulated from one another and are treated in such a way as to be sensitive to light. However, it required several man years of patient investigation before we could understand exactly how it worked and produce this tube, which is the one that was used for the opening of the television service at Alexandra Palace by the BBC in 1936. This tube we had to make in secret, because in fact the EMI management at that time were not interested in the transmission side of television.
But another company was very interested. In July 1933, after 7 years' work, Vladimir Zvorykin, working for RCA in America, published his paper on the iconoscope, a television transmitter using a cathode ray tube. Zvorykin's system was essentially the same as the one that Tedeman McGee produced, but had not publicly described 9 months before. But Zvorykin was the first to publish an account of his tube, so it is Zvorykin who must have the scientific credit. In 1932, EMI had linked up with Marconi.
The publication of Zvorykin's paper finally convinced EMI that all electronic television really did have a future. And in the autumn of 1933, I was given the task of developing the first electronic camera. Without an electronic camera, there would be no television, at least as we now know it.
Es ist eine Folgensagen! Jawohl!
In the year that Baird went on the air at Broadcasting House, EMI began the research that was to lead to a television breakthrough.
We could learn very little from Zvorykin's paper, and we got no help from the RCA. But we did know that we were in competition not only with the RCA, but Farnsworth Company in the USA, and with Telefunken and the Fernseh AG in Germany.
Über alles, Deutschland has the best television! Sieg Heil!
Well done. Schoenberg was shown the first experimental Emitron camera on January the 29th, 1934. As a result, EMI switched its research effort from a part mechanical to an all-electronic system.
Gentlemen, we are embarked on an uncharted ocean. And God knows if we will ever reach a port.
Bernard Greenhead was one of the junior members of the EMI research team.
Mr. Ashbridge and Douglas Birkinshaw came down on several occasions. We had the feeling that we got to impress these people because the BBC were only customers. Apart from producing pictures from our little studio, we always gave them the famous canal shot. We pointed the camera out of the window down to the canal where there was always plenty of contrast and movement. And additionally, the light reflected from the water certainly improved the quality of the picture. I thought Mr. Schoenberg was an excellent salesman. There you are, Mr. Respidge. What do you think? The best pictures in the world.
Prying eye. Can television see into your home? Doctors fear television rays will wreck their machines. Will television rays sterilize the population?
Very early on, I was given the task to check whether the X-rays produced by the electrons in the cathode ray tubes would be injurious to human health. We were quite confident that the effect would be negligible, but we had to produce cast iron evidence to counter the propaganda that was being put out quite unscrupulously by the Baird Company.
Baird personally lobbied the Prince of Wales and the BBC's Controller of Engineering.
13th of January, 1933, to Noel Ashbridge, BBC. Dear Mr. Ashbridge, I hope to be in a position to show you a 240-line picture in the second week of February. I also hope to be in a position to show you our latest results with a cathode ray tube, although I do not think that it by any means supersedes mechanical systems.
I know you are experienced enough to know that cathode rays, far from being revolutionary, is one of the oldest systems known.
1st of February, 1933. Dear Noel, the enclosed letter from Mr. Baird takes me rather out of my depth, and His Royal Highness thinks that I'd better send it to you. I'm afraid I know very little about the present situation in regard to television.
And cannot pass any opinion on the suggestion that the BBC are crushing a pioneer British industry or giving secret encouragement to alien interests. Yours ever, Godfrey. Dear Godfrey, so far, the Baird Company has not given us a demonstration of high-definition television. As a result of pressure from us, they have actually promised demonstrations on two or three occasions, but these have not taken place. It is not true
to say that the electrical and musical industry system is American, having regard to the fact that it has been wholly developed and manufactured by British staff in English workshops.
To look into the future of television, the government set up the Selsdon Committee. It began taking evidence in 1934 to decide whether there should be a public television service, and if so, the best system of transmission. It reported in January 1935.
This afternoon in the House of Commons, I announced a most important decision of the government on the subject of television. That latest miracle of scientific achievement, which is now arousing so much interest. Broadcast television can perhaps best be described if I asked you to imagine that in the center of your present wireless set, there was a little square of glass on which you could now see me as I sit here in the studio at Broadcasting House. Whether that picture would add to your enjoyment, it is not for me to suggest. However, it is proposed that two systems of high-definition television should be tried at the London station.
Television blow from BBC. End of 30-line low-definition television. Mr. J.L. Baird, television pioneer, told the Daily Mirror last night,
"It will mean that thousands of sets will become obsolete."
But you will be glad to know that there is no suggestion of an increase in the 10-shilling fee for the broadcast listener's license.
In the first public experimental television system, which we started in 1932, we used low-definition television. That's to say, we divided the picture into no more than 30 lines. But for modern television, something much better was required, and the Selsdon Committee hoped for not less than 240. The Baird Company offered this figure, but EMI's went as high as 405 lines, which they were quite confident that they could do. And this was a most courageous decision by their television director, Isaac Schoenberg. Also, it was made at a time when they had never created any equipment to exploit this standard. So they had to set to work and do this very quickly, as the Selsdon Committee were expecting results within the year. In the meantime, the BBC set to work to find a site.
The selection of a site for the first television station presented many difficulties of which the public know little. Eventually, the Alexandra Palace was chosen.
This 40-year-old film ranks as the first TV documentary. The commentary voice is mine.
In November 1935, the work of reconstruction was begun on the southeast wing. To convert the old palace into the headquarters of the latest miracle in electrical communication, complete reconstruction was necessary, so that the building might house the transmitters, control rooms, studios, and all the complicated apparatus of the two television systems. The ground floor had to be made solid enough to bed heavy generators and rotary converters, which are part of the transmitting equipment. In the Baird transmitting hall alone, there are 12 heavy motor generators. It was at about this time that Vladimir Zvorykin, originator of the television camera, visited the director of television at Alexandra Palace. Mr. John Logie Baird is well known as the pioneer of British television. Here is some of the Baird apparatus: the transmitting valves, the spotlight scanner, the spotlight studio, in which photocells take the place of lights, and the telecine projection room with the projector in course of erection.
Both the Baird and EMI equipment were so new as to be largely unpatented. And it was part of my job to see that there was no leakage of secrets between the companies via the BBC. The Baird system had many points of excellence, but the EMI system carried the frontiers of electrical design forward to a degree of sophistication never seen before. It is an almost unbelievable fact that the detailed design of the EMI 405 line system was done by Blumlein, Brown, White, and one or two of the others over 48 hours during one dedicated weekend at Brown's house. I remember something that Isaac Schoenberg once said to me. Mr. Birkinshaw, we are lighting a candle which will not be put out.
The BBC is conducting a search for Superwoman. She must have super personality, charm, tact, a mezzo voice, and a good memory.
She must be as acceptable to women as to men. She must photograph well, she must not have red hair, and must not be married.
Miss Elizabeth Cowell is a true brunette with soft brown eyes, with a lively face which one would call chic rather than beautiful.
They wanted somebody of moderate education, who had never been on the stage, of average intelligence, and is able to cope with life.
Miss Jasmine Bligh, niece of Lord Darnley and descended from Captain Bligh of the Bounty, is more serious and dignified. An auburn blonde, statuesque, really beautiful and queenly.
They wanted to know what our legs were like. Now, we never showed our legs on television. So instead of saying, Miss Bligh, would you raise your skirt slightly, they made us climb up three steps and get onto a table. Apparently they discovered what they wanted to discover.
I remember Jasmine and I were finally told in Broadcasting House, I think it was April, that we'd got the job, but we wouldn't get it if we told anybody at all.
And so we were taken round the BBC, introduced to all sorts of people, faced an enormous gathering of the press, who I know in my case tried to make out I'd got the job because I had a boyfriend in the BBC, which actually was untrue.
Our job was announcer, and I suppose they called us hostess, which is now rather a dirty word, isn't it?
We opened a service and closed the service and gave little introductions in between. But apart from that, we had to look after the stars who came up, who didn't know their way around, who'd never been on television before, and were frequently very nervous indeed.
One day was an onion seller, another day was King Boris of Bulgaria. So you met people from all walks of life.
We couldn't take them to the nearest bar, which you can do now to, you know, give them a bit of confidence. There was no drinking at all in the whole of the building. And the only drink was in Matron's room, in a locked cupboard which consisted of half a bottle of brandy. And you only got any of that if you were dying.
Frightfully little pay, but it was gorgeous to get it. I long to tell you something, but I think I'm not allowed to. £25 a year for a dress allowance, so we could only dress to here. So what happened there was nobody's business.
In August, Gerald Cock, who was the new director of television, just been appointed, assembled us all in the council chamber at Broadcasting House and told us our jobs.
Cecil Madden, the first television producer.
He then said, I know nothing about television, none of you do, so nobody can pretend they do. But you've got about 4 months to think, to decide what you're all going to do and how the cameras work and everything. So I suggest that you all pile yourself into cars, go out to Alexandra Palace in North London and have a look at your offices. Well, we did this. I was on the third floor, my name was on the door on the same floor as his office. I opened the door, there wasn't a stick of furniture in it, but the phone was in the corner and the phone was ringing merrily. So with some trepidation, I crossed the room, picked it up, there was Gerald Cock. Ah, Cecil, I'm so glad I caught you. He said, wash out everything I said. The radio show at Radio Olympia has been a great failure. They can't sell the stands. They think television could save them. Now, he said, listen carefully, I've agreed. Don't muck about. This means programs in about 9 days' time.
Hello, Radio Olympia. This is direct television from the studios at Alexandra Palace. And now you're going to see and hear someone you know well, Miss Helen Mackay.
From that first program, this is the only material to survive. Apart from the large orchestra that for the most part was concealed by curtains, The show was mounted under Spartan conditions. What follows this old film is a reconstruction of the show from photographs and original scripts, and it's performed in the original cramped studio at Alexandra Palace.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, the three admirals.
In the olden days, the belle of any ball used to be the toast of fellows one and all. Now the television's at our beck and call. I'll play host.
Here's my toast.
Here's looking at you from out of the blue. Don't make.
I got Ronnie Hill to write a song for the show, and he came up with the title, Here's Looking at You. And this caught my imagination. I thought, well, instead of calling it Variety, let us call the whole show Here's Looking at You.
That radio can let you sit and watch the show. This wonderful age goes to show that all the world is a stage. First you heard,
now you see,
and you wonder what the next thing on the list will be. What hullabaloo, we're just peeping through to say how do. Here's looking at you.
Our big problem was that you couldn't cut between cameras. You could only mix. And the mix took 8 seconds. We only had one monitor, so we couldn't be sure exactly what pictures we were taking. It was a terrible worry because you could miss the point of the action altogether. Each time we did it, the show got a little faster, and so we always prayed that the techniques in the control room would keep up so that we all achieved the same result at the same time.
Thank you, the three admirals. We now come to the final part of this experimental demonstration, direct television by the Marconi EMI system, which means that you are watching a program that is actually going on now. So in conclusion, we have two international entertainers new to this country, Carol Chilton and Maceo Thomas, who are going to present their song and dance act, which they call Tapping in Rhythm. So, ladies and gentlemen, here's looking at Chilton and Thomas.
BBC executives, I think, were very sceptical about television as a whole. However, when they could see cameras and lights and colour and movement and artists and speed and all the things that we were doing, which was really very exciting for a medium that had never had anything but sound in the past, I think when they could do that at the Alexandra Palace and then go to Radio Olympia and see the results and the crowds standing around these sets in their hundreds and thousands. Even they could see that television had arrived.
BBC executives were, on the whole, impressed.
If I had gone through the radio show simply as a member of the public, I should have come out feeling that I would buy a television set. But at 95 guineas, not for some time. Nevertheless, Gerald, things were, on the whole, better than I expected. And I can now contemplate, with less misgivings, our official opening.
Well, once we'd got the official opening of November over, we had to work in alternate weeks, Studio A, the Marconi EMI system, and Studio B, the Baird system. Now, it very quickly got round to the artists that they were not going to be shown to very good advantage on the Baird system, so some of the leading people toiled all the way out to Alexandra Palace and knelt down at my desk and prayed not to go on in the Baird week. So you can see what they thought about it. As producers, I'm afraid we also hated the Baird studio and the apparatus.
Ladies and gentlemen, someone whom you've often heard in sound broadcasting, whom you are now going to see for the first time. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Peter Dawson.
This embarrassing moment actually occurred in full view of the television audience in December 1936.
Mr. Dawson, I wondered if you prefer to sit down.
I usually stand.
I think the viewers would be able to see better.
Very well.
The Baird camera was bolted to the floor. If a performer missed his mark and came too far forward, he'd be out of the picture.
Buy a television set. But at 95 guineas, not for some time. Nevertheless, Gerald, things were, on the whole, better than I expected. And I can now contemplate, with less misgivings, our official opening.
Well, once we'd got the official opening of November over, we had to work in alternate weeks, Studio A, the Marconi EMI system, and Studio B, the Baird system. Now, it very quickly got round to the artists that they were not going to be shown to very good advantage on the Baird system, so some of the leading people toiled all the way out to Alexandra Palace and knelt down at my desk and prayed not to go on in the Baird week. So you can see what they thought about it. As producers, I'm afraid we also hated the Baird studio and the apparatus.
Ladies and gentlemen, someone whom you've often heard in sound broadcasting, whom you are now going to see for the first time. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Peter Dawson.
This embarrassing moment actually occurred in full view of the television audience in December 1936.
Mr. Dawson, I wondered if you prefer to sit down.
I usually stand.
I think the viewers would be able to see better.
Very well.
The Baird camera was bolted to the floor. If a performer missed his mark and came too far forward, he'd be out of the picture.
Ladies and gentlemen, now I hope you can all see Mr. Peter Dawson. In charge of the Baird technique was J.D. Percy.
Television was then synonymous with seeing what was happening at the moment that it happened. Baird could only do this with close-up newsreader-type shots. The Baird Company did have a very early type of electron camera, but it was never sensitive enough to give a good picture. What we did have was a very good film scanner, which was then producing from film the best and clearest television picture in the world. This was the sole reason why the Selsdon Committee invited Baird to compete at the Alexander Palace at all. And it was from that telecine that this, the infamous Baird intermediate film scanner, surely the great granddaddy of all canned program machines, was developed. The intermediate film machine was the nearest Baird ever got to transmitting high-definition studio scenes. The studio performance was first filmed by this conventional film camera here, and the film came straight into these processing tanks where it was developed, washed, fixed in a solution of cyanide, and scanned while the film was still actually running through water here by a standard Baird Nipkow disc. Baird, of course, used the Nipkow disc in all his equipment from the very beginning. The time taken between filming here and transmission at the gate was 54 seconds. Because it was scanned while still passing through a bath of water, bubbles often collected in the scanning gate, which didn't exactly help the picture quality, or bits of emulsion would peel off in the processing tanks and form a kind of scum on the film. And a continuous supply of clean, cold water was also required, and if this faltered, the whole rig would go dead. Sometimes the chemical solutions, including some cyanide, spilled onto the tiled floor, and then Liz Cowell generally trailed her long frock into it and had to be hosed down quick. And as we also had 10,000 volts and this disc here spinning at 6,000 RPM, all in the cramped little scanning room, rehearsals and transmissions were always exciting.
We hated it when we knew we had to use it, realizing what wonderful results we could obtain next door on the Marconi EMI system. So it was a bit like using the Morse code when you knew you could telephone.
Well, I don't think there was any advantage in the Baird system. In fact, it used to cause unbelievable chaos because it was intermediate film, which meant that the program in Studio A would be stopping, and before it had stopped, the program in Studio B would have to begin. And if the timing wasn't right, you can imagine what happened. There was one small advantage, that you could make your announcement at the beginning of the program and rush into the control room and see how well or how badly you'd done. And I was so bad that the head of television called us into the office and said, if you don't improve within the next 2 or 3 months, we shall dispense with your services.
BBC Television, this is the switchboard of Picture Page, a topical magazine introducing visitors, types and personalities. You're through. You're looking at who? Miss Joan Miller?
Yes, this is Joan Miller. And Picture Page was the very first television magazine program in the world. Cecil Madden asked me to be in it, and I was delighted. I had just arrived from Canada, and I had written a little comedy sketch for him about an American telephone girl, and that put the idea of the switchboard into his mind. When I came into the studio, I said to him, well, what shall I wear? And he looked around, and his eye lit on a technician's overall, and he said, wear that. That's how I got my white coat. I wrote all my own lines, and I used to hold imaginary conversations with our viewers, something like this. BBC Television, you want to see Britain's youngest film star? Certainly. You're through. You're looking at Dinah Sheridan.
Dinah Sheridan. You can't still be 16, but you look particularly like it. What did you feel about this tremendous build-up as the youngest film star?
Well, of course, it was very flattering and frightening. I really didn't think I could live up to it.
You were very good. You didn't seem scared at all.
Oh, I was. Were you? Of course I was. Yes.
How did they get you? Did they advertise or did they bring you up? What happened?
Yeah, the rather extraordinary story. I was studying at that time at a stage drama school in London, living in Welwyn Garden City, and my sister and I and a lot of other students used to catch the 5:10 train home every night. And we were almost like a club. We filled one carriage and we had the evening news crossword we did, and we had fruit and sweets and things. And woe betide anybody else who got into that carriage.
Yes, sir, sure.
And one day, a poor benighted man got in, sat in the corner and suffered all the way to Welwyn Garden City. And that day, I'm afraid, we had cherries and we were flicking cherry stones all over the place. We really weren't very nice to know. However, when I got home, the telephone rang, my mother answered and came and said, a man says he is the one who was sitting in the railway carriage. He would like to speak to you.
Hutch.
Well, I thought, oh God, he's going to complain about the cherry stones. But no, the voice said, my name is Leslie Bailey. Would you like to be on television?
What fun. So that's how it happened. Of course, from our point of view, it really was rather difficult sometimes because we didn't know who on earth was coming up until the scout found somebody interesting enough. And they were brought up here at very short notice. And of course, the BBC pundits went mad because in radio, of course, you could plan months and months ahead. Whereas here, it happened on the day. And I think the scouts, if they succeeded in getting somebody taken, got something like 3 guineas, I think it was.
3 guineas for getting us here.
Mm-hmm.
I got 2 guineas for being got. I did. And the whole interview, from my point of view, I can remember, was scripted. But I had to learn it. It was absolutely cut and dried. But I wasn't allowed to hold a script, of course, as you do in radio. Mm. No, I had to learn it entirely by heart.
Now, that comes of being professional, you see.
Well, it wasn't very easy. And I do remember the producer saying to me at one time, now, loosen up a bit, relax, don't sound so studied. So I hope I'm doing better now. What I do remember very clearly were the specific instructions the producer gave us. You never turned your head sideways, otherwise your nose suddenly came out like, yes, Pinocchio. And no gestures straight towards the camera like that, otherwise whole hand, yes, would fill the screen. And now what else was there? Well, above all, really, no gestures at all.
None at all.
I think you were allowed to shake with fright, but apart from that, otherwise everything was directed straight into the camera lens.
And behind the lens was cameraman John Bliss.
One problem with the original EMI cameras was that they had no viewfinders. Now, this didn't matter when you could set up a stationary camera because it could be lined up and adjusted and focused on instructions from the control room. But very soon, producers wanted something more than this and wanted to move cameras about in shot. And we had to improvise a rather crude viewfinder mounted on top of the camera, made of plywood, string and wire. And this served well enough for a while. But fairly soon after the service was started, EMI designed and produced a two twin lens viewfinder like this one, which in fact made the cameraman's job much easier as he could see exactly what was happening.
BBC Television? Who? Oh, yes, indeed. She's tall. She's beautiful. She has a wardrobe any girl would envy. You are through. You're looking at Television Tilly.
Evening, Tilly. She's been like this all the time. We joined Television the same week, and she's never spoken to me since. She's always been a little cold and aloof, probably because she's left out in the corridor all night and doesn't get quite defrozen. Tilly, to speak seriously, was in fact put there as a test for materials, for colors, and for makeup. As you'll see, on her left side, she's made up for EMI, and on the right side, for Baird. We use them, of course, separately. And the materials were particularly important because on occasions with a red-sensitive camera, the reds of a dress would tone in with the flesh tones, and they would appear to be completely naked, the people who came in that color. Television Tilly came into Picture Page because of the absence of somebody who should have turned up. And Cecil Madden, the producer, said to me, well, interview her for 4 minutes, which I did. And I took her hand like this, and it came off in mine. And after 4 minutes, I said, thanks for the hand. I'm sorry.
Sometimes when I was about to put a guest through, I would hear the director's voice saying, sorry, Joan, that camera's broken down. We can't go through yet. Keep talking. And so I became an expert ad-libber. In fact, I think Leslie and I were the best ad-libbers in London. Finally, the director would say, all right, go through, Joan, and I would announce the guest. And always I had to say,
you're through. You're looking at Pipe Major Massey, the bagpipes man from Trafalgar Square. Harry Haynes, a muffin man. You're looking at the racecourse character, Grand Prince Modelulu. You're looking at the pearly king and queen of Blackfriars, Mr. and Mrs. Tinsley. You're looking at...
Remember where you are and temper your hilarity with a modicum of reserve. Have you heard this one?
To a lady at the AP, penned at the time by Mr. J.D. Percy, who had been so valiantly in charge of the Baird equipment. Close on 8:30 at night, standing in a pool of light, looking cool but feeling hot from the focused kilowatt. Patiently, you wait your cue. Patiently, I wait for you. Through a lens, your image flies, mouth and nose and ears and eyes, into little pieces break on a sensitive mosaic. Finer than the finest sand, electronically scanned. Lady, do you realize now you have no ears or eyes, and in little separate bits, now your pulsing signal flits, lightly as a fairy fable, down a multi-channel cable, conjured out of space at last by the dipole on my mast, down concentric feed-in wire to a corner by my fire, through the vision superhet of my television set.
Look you. Television looker was the term coined at the Television Inquiry to describe one who looks in.
There must be a better designation. The Daily Express offers 5 guineas. Television observer, teleseer, teleperceptor, televist, telegazer, telespector, telesight, telescriber, audio observer, audio seer, audio vist, invider, visioner, visualizer, beholder, bearder, opticarius. Were the main suggestions. It was the BBC themselves who started using the term viewer.
His Master's Voice Television. Sight and sound in your home for £1 a week.
And there was almost as much variety of programme then as now.
Over 6'2", who's the king of Lennox Avenue? Someone different with a something new. Papa Tree Top Tall. Now every gigolo goes around complaining times are slow. Since the Harlem babies came to know Papa Tree Top Tall.
I believe that what sound broadcasting has done for music, television may do for painting and sculpture. In the last few months, I've been taking works from the London galleries to the Alexandra Palace and commenting on them and showing them. This is a carving by the young English sculptor Henry Moore.
The wrap with this bathing suit worn by Maquette is of silver silk oilskin. The bathing suit is telescopic and adapts silk to any figure. The colors are gray, white, and black in a square pattern.
And a little known ballerina from Sadler's Wells, Margot Fontaine, graced a now increasing number of private TV screens with her exquisite dancing.
Demonstrate your methods on my hands, Dr. Charlotte Wolf.
With greatest pleasure. But you must remember that I'm a scientist, and a proper analysis takes us more than 1 hour, so I can only give some general indication. I consider your hands...
The doctor's guinea pig is Jasmine Bly.
...dominated by the zone of instincts. I imagine that you could find your way alone in the dark.
Yes, I can.
The following is an extract from the BBC viewer research, based on a sample of 74 viewers. 21 viewers watched on Baird television sets, 17 on HMV, 12 on Marconi, and 24 on other sets. Disapproval concentrated largely on the demonstrations of cooking, washing, and ironing, which, it was pointed out, were of little interest to those who could afford television sets.
In these early days, the television programme didn't start until 9 o'clock in the evening and finished at about 10:15. So, quite reasonably, it was regarded as a great event. Dinner would be got out of the way, and the set would be switched on at 9:15, and everybody waited with great expectancy. Quite different from now, when people say, "What's on the box tonight?"
The BBC, following the period of experiment, will, from February the 5th, 1937, continue to broadcast its television programmes in the Marconi EMI system only.
He took this blow philosophically. I mean, what else could he do? I don't think perhaps he expected anything else. Although the pictures compared very well. They're very good pictures, both companies. You know, very similar pictures, but it was a different system, you see, which everyone knows now.
Everyone at Alexander Palace was very kind while we were fighting and losing Baird's last battle. However, there was no stopping the advance of the flickerless, tireless, inertialess electron camera. So sadly, we pulled out the Baird circuit breakers for the last time, turned off the taps on the old intermediate film, carefully disposed of the chemicals, and went home.
It has been announced this morning from Buckingham Palace that the coronation of their Majesties King George VI and Queen Elizabeth will take place in Westminster Abbey on May the 12th.
This is the coronation waltz. Let us sway on our way to romance. This is the coronation waltz. We can dream to its theme while we dance.
The BBC, with absolutely no previous experience, plunged into the world's first major television outside broadcast.
Ladies and gentlemen, as you know, it's the intention of the BBC to be present tomorrow at the coronation of their Majesties. The corporation have made elaborate plans for this special television broadcast, and in tonight's programme, we want to explain to the viewer some of the equipment that has been specially made for the BBC.
At EMI, we worked all the hours that God gave to get the things ready in time. The mobile control room was basically the Alexander Palace studio equipment on wheels. Inside, we had channels for 4 electronic cameras and 2 picture monitors so that the men working inside the van could see the pictures being shot by the cameraman outside. The equipment was so heavy that the chassis of the van had to be specially strengthened. It was surprising that the thing moved at all.
In order to convey the pictures from the coronation route to the Alexander Palace transmitter, 8 miles of special cable have been constructed and laid under the streets of London. In charge of this, the first ever high-definition television outside broadcast will be senior studio engineer T.H. Bridgewater.
We parked the mobile control room and the other vehicles on the grass under the trees behind here. And we've chosen this site, Apsley Gate, as a well-known London scene, and one from which we hoped to get excellent views of the procession coming down the east carriage drive of Hyde Park here, and then going through the arch and beyond over Hyde Park Corner and into Constitution Hill.
we are at Epsley Gate. The route here is lined by RAF troops. They've just had their rations issued to them. They must be quite ready for them, poor chaps. They've been here since crack of dawn, but then so have we.
BBC sent us an enormous food hamper with cold meats and wine and fruit. In fact, we were treated like lords, and indeed we felt like lords. There was nothing that we would sooner have been on that day than a member of the BBC's television crew.
Now we've got three cameras working today, and they're linked up to our new television bands, which transmit to the main transmitter at Alexandra Palace. We've got two of our cameras high up on the gate itself, one looking up the East Carriage Drive. This will catch the procession as it comes into view, and the other that will take the tail of the procession after it's passed by us. The third one on the pavement is within some 3 or more feet of the royal coach as it comes by.
And here I was, right on the edge of the pavement, with a wonderful view of everything, except, of course, in my viewfinder, it was upside down. At one stage, an assistant commissioner of police arrived and thought that we were very near and likely to frighten the horses. We reassured him, but when the time came, every blessed horse did shy at us. Anyway, we tested all our circuits and then sat down to wait.
A last look round the camera on the pavement to see that everything's all right. And now, I'm sorry to say that conditions are against us. It started to rain and the light is none too good, but we'll stick to it and hope for the best. It's very bad luck, as had it been an hour ago, everything would have been perfect. But now here's the head of the procession, Colonel Grant Sutty, with 4 troopers of the Household Cavalry. The band of the 1st Warwicks leading on detachments of the Territorials.
I was inside the control van, and just as we heard that the procession had entered the Marble Arch, we lost the picture. We had standby electronic generators and transmission channels, but switching to them did absolutely no good at all. We could even hear the sound of horses' hooves getting closer and closer, and still nothing. In sheer desperation, I gave the appropriate panel a thump, and it worked.
Give place to the royal procession of state coaches. Queen Mary in her state coach. Those 8 magnificent greys drawing on that almost unbelievable state coach with their majesties, the King and Queen.
The coronation was seen by an estimated 50,000 people and was received over 63 miles away. The climax of the first 9 months of British television, it made television respectable. And the British had beaten the rest of the world to a high-definition public television service by over 3 years. Television as we know it in this country was the achievement of A.A. Campbell-Swinton, of the research team of EMI, of the pioneer engineers, artists, producers, cameramen and technicians, and of the man who first made television work, gave it publicity and impetus, if not the final system, John Logie Baird.
He stuck to his mechanical system, you know, this was the trouble, that he tried to weather every storm, more or less, on his own, because he had been the first person to get a working television picture. And it became an obsession with him. He probably was the last of the men who worked in attics, and he struggled along alone.
Show that all the world is a stage. First you thing on the list will be one of the